bringing you all of the local motocross racing from North Carolina, Virginia, and the surrounding states. The Imperative MX Podcast. Here's another episode.
And we're back and ready to rip here on the Imperative MX Podcast, episode number 21. And man, we're glad to be back for another week and another episode. We are bringing you all of the local motocross action from North Carolina, Virginia, and the surrounding states. Thank you so much for joining us this week on yet another episode. I am your host, Zach Newberry. And we would like to thank everyone who has been enjoying these first couple of episodes already and the great positive feedback from these, from you guys, the listeners, has been phenomenal. If you have not yet checked out any of the past episodes, make sure to do yourselves a favor and check them out after this one, which is now available everywhere. Apple, Spotify, Amazon Music, YouTube, Pandora, Listen Notes, and many more to choose from to listen to the past episodes with awesome guests. It is fantastic to see the support from the local community and even outside the local community's support in the sport of motocross. And we are a part, all of us, even you, the listeners, are a part of an awesome sport. And I want to thank you guys, the listeners, of course, for tuning in to this week's episode here on the Imperative MX Podcast for yet another great episode. And speaking of great episodes, we have a lot to talk about when it comes to local racing all the way to professional and everything in between. With that, there are a good amount of talking points to chat about within this episode. First, we're going to actually switch up the gears here on the podcast and not actually start with local motocross, but don't worry, we're going to get there and you're going to see why, but we do have a call-in from second-place rider overall in the AMA Arenacross Series this year, Kyle Bitterman, about his Arenacross season, about doing some Supercross races this year, what the plan for the remainder of this year for him, and much more. And then we will get back into local motocross with the highly favorited local legend segment with none other than Jed Drye about everything that went down at the Ridge. He was part of the crew that put the whole thing together, so it'll be awesome to talk to him about that. Riding, actually, or in racing, actually, my RMZ 450 on Sunday, and much more to get in from Jed Drye. I've known that guy for such a long time. It's going to be good to finally have him on the podcast. And then finally, after all of that, we will break down all of the action heading into, it's a little bit of like a preview, heading into round 12 of the Monster Energy AMA Supercross Championship that happens this weekend in Glendale for the third Triple Crown of the year. But make sure to check us out by searching Imperative MX on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and our popular TikTok channel if you have not already done so. And thank you guys so much for supporting us on all of the social media platforms as we continue to grow. Before we go any further, we have to say thank you to all of the sponsors on board here on the Imperative MX Podcast. West Virginia Motorsports, FXR, Silver Valley MX Park, Hydropower, Dirt Industries Custom Graphics, Mika Metals, and the brand new sponsor on board, Total Control Racing Suspensions. And don't forget to check out ImperativeMX.com when you get a chance. A ton of new things are in the works and already live. I'm not going to lie, I've been lacking this week, but work, my full-time work has been absolutely destroying me this week and starting to get hot. But anyways, there's so much things that I'm getting ready to do on the website, so make sure to go and check that out. Purchase those products directly from the link on the website at the top of the banner. Quick and easy for you guys. We'll be doing updates, reads, galleries, and so much more here in 2023, so be on the lookout for more coming on ImperativeMX.com. And of course, we will get into each of these awesome companies beyond us here in just a bit. Support the ones that support the sport, like these companies helping us out to bring you these podcasts weekly and helping me break down all of the talking points for tonight's podcast, the highly likable, knowledgeable, and of course, your District 29 2011 C-Class champion, co-host Heavy D. What's going on, Heavy?
What's up, dog?
What are you doing?
Oh, dude, sitting here chilling with my lady and the youngin'. And dude, I'm sorry, but we love how you bring me in, bro. I feel so accomplished.
Yeah, you all hyped up?
Oh, dude, I get so stoked. I feel like John Jones when he made his return to UFC.
Oh, man, that is so good. Man, we have a lot to get into this in this new episode. And, of course, we were at the Ridge this weekend, and we got to announce in the Tower. Man, we have a lot to break down. And before we get into anything, West Virginia Motorsports, if you are looking for your next ride, look no further than my friends over at West Virginia Motorsports. If you are around the surrounding area and looking for a brand new pre-owned motorcycle, dirt bike, ATV, UTV, whatever it is, make sure to stop by Princeton, West Virginia, and go to West Virginia Powers or Motorsports. Don't forget to order your parts for your current bike through West Virginia Motorsports or alongside walking out the door with that brand new ride. Find your key to fun. Don't forget to grab those oil filters and air filters on the way out with whatever ride you have. And, of course, Heavy D, do not catch them on fire. And I cannot believe at the Ridge, there was no stories of anybody trying to recreate that. So, thank God, Heavy D.
Yeah, you got that right. Mm-hmm. You got that right.
Don't do that. Don't do that.
No. You don't want to do that. Trust me. No, you know what? Trust you. Yeah. Trust you.
Yeah. Don't, just don't. Man, before we bring Kyle Bitterman here on the Imperative MX podcast, but Heavy D, man, we had a great time at the Ridge this weekend for the return there in beautiful Sanford, Virginia. You stayed at my pop's crib, which is in Pittsburgh, which isn't too far down the road. Man, I had a great weekend, and I know you did too.
Oh, dude, it was so sick, bro. Like, I'm still, like, super, like, beyond pumped on how the weekend went. Like, the racing was unreal, you know. Got to watch Jebediah shred the RMZ.
Yep.
And, you know, got to watch, you know, honestly, we got to announce the return of an iconic track, one of the most iconic tracks in, you know, the North Carolina, South Carolina area. And, dude, it was so sick, honestly. Like, the atmosphere, like, I think everything went so smooth. It's crazy how smooth it went.
Yeah, man, it really did. Even on Saturday when we had a little bit of intermission because of the rain that came through, man, people thought that we were, you know, just having the podcast up there and we were just doing whatever. But realistically, me and you just sat up there and chit-chatted the entire time about local motocross racing, and it seemed like a lot of people really, really appreciated that.
Oh, 100%. You know, what I really liked the most, too, is, you know, as a kid, I listened to the announcer, you know, but I never, like, listened. And I thought it was cool, like, the amount of kids that came up and was, like, super, like, into what we were talking about and asking questions, like, about, you know, you racing Tomac and those guys and who we raced. It's like they wanted to know more. It's almost as if we didn't give enough detail.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody was still pumped on it, but it's like, I think that they were just super interested in, like, the backgrounds and stuff. You know, your background, my background, and just, you know, the places we've been in the sport. And I think it was pretty cool, like, you know, for the locals, you know, just to get a little bit more insight. And I think it was just all around good. They wanted to hear what we had to say. That's what I really liked the most.
Yeah, absolutely. And one of the things that we talked about was just growing the sport and trying to do the best that we can to grow it, even at a local level. And, you know, there was so much deep and rich history within that place, just as far as AMA goes and just the area and the dirt. I mean, it's a gnarly track, Heavy D. It got gnarly there on Sunday.
Oh, dude, it got so gnarly. I was like, okay, like, this is what I'm talking about. Like, that's why I like so many of the changes they made. You know, I know we ain't getting super into it because we're gonna talk about it later, but that's what I like about the changes they made as well. Like, it made it even more raceable and more spectator friendly. Like, it was sweet before, but like the lines and how it all flowed, it just made for some fantastic racing, dude. So the whole track was just raceable, and you could just look at it and tell.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, just from us being in the announcer's tower the first time, and we got to really just look around and see everything, and I mean, we really could see everything, and yeah, they changed so much to the track, and of course, like you said, we'll get into it in a little bit, but yeah, just like you, man, I'm so stoked and can't wait for the next time that we go to the Ridge and how iconic it was, and we were in the booth, and we had live timing up there. I mean, it was pretty crazy, but we'll talk about that here in just a little bit. But let's switch gears a little bit and talk with second overall in the AMA Arenacross Series this year, lasting impressions Honda racer Kyle Bitterman. Miko Metals strives to be the leader in product quality. Their bars are constructed of 6061 aerospace aluminum and have a unique design that allows them to retain maximum strength while still having the flex riders desire. Mika sprockets are made from 7075 aerospace aluminum, the highest standard in the industry. Their unique tooth design maximizes wear and lets you ride longer. So make sure to go and check out MikaMetals.com. Check out their inventory and see for yourself. And speaking of Mika Metals, we have one of their riders on the phone right now. Kyle Bitterman, you finished second overall this year. I appreciate you coming on to the Imperative MX podcast.
Absolutely, yeah. And absolutely, Mika Metals, that's what we run, bars, sprockets, chains, grips, all that stuff. But yeah, no, man, we're out here at bike night in Greenville with my uncle, and we're having a good time, and figured come on and talk to you guys as well.
Yeah man, it's been a while. We talked to you after round number one, after that crazy crash over the finish line in the heat race, and now we're at the end of the AMA Arenacross season, and man, you came up just short on KP again, but amazing battles throughout, an amazing season. I watched every single race through Ride TV. How do you feel afterwards now, looking back on it, since it's been about a week or so since the finale?
Yeah, you know, overall, I'm pumped how it turned out. You know, to come second, I was second last year. You know, you always strive to be number one, but KP's good, man. But, hey, if I could say where we started to where we are now, we just made myself, our team, we all made crazy progress, like, throwback to round one, you know, I rode my 450. We didn't even have our race bike yet. I had surgery in December. Then we kind of got the ball back rolling in January. And from that point on, we just got a little better to the point where we were kind of fighting for possible wins. And we never fully got that W that we wanted and we were looking for. But, I was becoming a better rider by the end of the season.
Yep.
And yeah, just, you know, I guess we're kind of going to keep that ball rolling going into 2024, so that's the plan.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, I know that there was a couple of races, and even Salem included, that, you know, you had the lead and just, you know, you just needed that little bit more to get it to, like, if the checkered flag waved like 3 or 4 laps before, you would have it. But yeah, KP just ended up getting you in the end, and man, it's gotta be almost kind of devastating. But at the same time, from where you guys were at in the beginning and with your surgery and all that to where you guys got to in the end, I mean, it's gotta be really good for yourself and the team to at least pull it off and come in second and do the entire series.
Yeah, exactly. Like you said, you know, I think we fought for, I think, 5 or 6 main event wins. And a lot of them, I think, were in the main two. So main two, you know, we only have a few minutes break between main one.
Yeah.
And the second main is, I think it's 2 minutes longer, which doesn't sound like much, but on arena cross track, it's like 4 or 5 extra laps. And those last 4 or 5 extra laps really put a damper on me. And I was already feeling it, and I just didn't have that little bit of spunk and fight for it. But
yeah,
hey, we're gonna work on that for next year. You know, we're gonna have more of a better off season. Me and the team has come up with a different plan, so we're gonna plan on staying on the bike throughout the summer and not kind of take so much break off, and you know, really come in to 2024 with a little bit more fight for the actual championship.
Yeah. Overall, how did you like the AMA Arenacross series this year compared to others, as far as just, you know, the logistics background and, you know, hyping you guys up and all of that? Like, as a whole, how did the whole AMA Arenacross championship go this year for you?
Man, the series was, like, kind of almost brought back to the glory days. I mean, maybe I didn't see the actual glory days. Maybe that was before my time. But I'm saying, like, from, you know, a little bit of the early areas of Feld, when Feld ran it with the Amsoil Arenacross, you know, we had real purse money, real end-of-the-year money that we're fighting for the AMA title. We have opening ceremonies. We got live music. We got a track party. We're signing autographs. We got the two mains, and it's more of a show. I think they've done a great job. Robbie, Jack, everybody in the Arenacross is definitely putting a lot of extra effort to try to get that, you know, that spark back that Arenacross once had, and they've worked the butt off, and they're planning on doing more for next year. So, and I know if anybody gets a chance to come out to one and check it out or watch them on TV. Honestly, it's way better in person than watching on TV. TV makes it look okay, but it's way better in person.
Oh, absolutely. And I was only able to, unfortunately, make one round this year, and next year, hopefully, we can make more. But that Salem track, man, it got a lot of guys. And, of course, in Arenacross, you know, you always have the top guys, and then you always have the lower set. But, man, at Salem, it seemed like it almost wanted to bite everybody.
Yeah, the few of the rounds, I think we got some dirt that was a bit on the soft side, maybe just, you know, maybe from the winter, or maybe a new dirt that hasn't been in that venue yet.
Yep.
That we were probably dealing with, and it just didn't have that time to dry out, and it got really ruddy and some soft spots, and like you're saying, it was catching a lot of people off guard. And if you don't have stiff enough suspension, or if you weren't prepared for it to kick you, or you know, send you in a different direction, it definitely bit you.
Yeah. Yeah, for sure. The Imperative MX Podcast, episode number 21 with Lasting Impressions, second overall in AMA Arenacross. Kyle Bitterman. Heavy D?
Yeah, sorry about that. So, you are coming back 2024.
That's the plan as of now, yes, sir.
Okay. Because I know I was at C21 the other week, and I was speaking to Ashley, not trying to put the team business out on Front Street. But, you know, I was curious because, you know, I know you got a family and everything, and you've been going at it pretty hard. But I just felt like a season like you had this year, I felt like this year you've kind of been closer, a lot closer this year than in years past. And it just seems like everything was, it just felt right. And y'all, you know, you and the team, you know, y'all made a huge step this year. So I just feel like I was thinking, you know, 2024, I wonder if he's coming back, because I feel like 2024 will be even better. You know?
Oh, absolutely. No, and you're 100% right. You know, I'm 30 now. I have a family, got a little boy. But, man, at 30, I don't think I've ever been so motivated. And the part of the reason is I feel like I've never reached my full potential in Arenacross or Supercross. Like, I've never, whether it's been financial, physical, or any of that, I just feel like I've never had that, my true potential, what I believe I think I could do. And until I get that, I'm not gonna stop trying. Eventually, you know, the time clock will eventually run out, but I still feel like I'm capable of doing it, and that's why I keep striving for it. And each year I do seem to get a little better, and some years you go backwards a little bit, but you take that experience and you take that knowledge that you learn of why you went backwards, and you kind of improve on that. And yeah, I think I can be a better rider next year. And I've learned a lot this year. I think I know what I needed to definitely work on my fitness and a couple small things in the program. And I think I can definitely be more of a title contender. We had tougher tracks this year, and I actually did better this year than previous year. So I'm riding better than I have in the past, and I just got to keep that ball going. Like I said, I got to stay on the bike throughout the summer and not take that big break off. And yeah, come into 2024 more willing to fight for it, you know.
Oh yeah, you know, that's to me, that's what I like. And you know, it's funny, like, I didn't even realize you were 30, Kyle. Man,
it's a big 3-0.
Yeah. Don't feel bad, Kyle. I'm about to turn 30 in June, so I'm right there with you.
No, I'm
30 going on 21.
Yeah, pretty much, right?
Like,
so,
that's what I'm saying. It's like, you know, I don't know if it's the fact that, like, you know, if some guys, it's like the older they get, it's like they start to pick it up more and the more knowledgeable they get. But I feel like also it's like I've seen you ride for years, and it's like, to me personally, I don't feel like the technology of the bikes was at the level of your riding, if that makes sense. I felt like your riding was above, like a little ahead of the bike technology coming up. And now I feel like you're on a bike that you gel with and it's comfortable for your riding style and technique, if that makes sense.
No, I'm right there with you. Just like, I've been struggling in the past 2 years, you know, on a steel frame bike, and those bikes are great, but for whatever reason, it just didn't suit me. We just could not get the setup on certain areas, you know, turning or hitting the whoops. We just were missing small parts in that setup. And like you're saying, I'm back on the Honda now, and I've seen the gel with it a lot better. And yeah, the bike's great. I think we can definitely improve in some areas of the motor just to make it more arena cross friendly, to have more of a bottom end grunt, you know.
Right.
We've learned a lot this year, and we're fine tuning our package. And like I was saying, for next year, we have some ideas and things we're definitely going to be working on throughout the summer.
Absolutely.
Oh,
tell us actually a little bit about the Lasting Impressions team that you're on. And it seems honestly like it's a complete family package with the whole crew, huh?
It really is. Honestly, the Lasting Impressions, they are a concrete company out of Tryon, North Carolina. And they're a family that I met probably, I believe it was 4 or 5 years ago. And I did a small little ride in school, and I trained his son, Ben. And ever since that day, they just kind of took a liking to me for whatever reason, and kind of always offered, you know, their support, their help, and asked me what I needed or what they could do to help me. And, you know, at the time, when I was doing that, I was almost burnt out of the sport.
Yeah.
You know, I've had so many promised things that never came through, or people that just don't pull through what they're telling you and what they want to do. And these guys just took a liking to me, and they threw some things at me, and we really kind of grew each year that I've been with them. And we went from just them helping us out to the next thing you know, we're kind of being like a small team, to the next thing you know, we got the motorhome and trailer, and they're driving around to all the races, and their kids racing the amateur, and their whole family's involved, and my family and the Telsky family. And so it's like you're saying, it's a big group of people that are just doing it for the love of the sport. And I'm definitely thankful enough that everyone's willing to go that extra mile just for me to go race a dirt bike. You know, like I tell people, at the end of the day, all we are is racing dirt bikes. And sometimes we make it out to be like the biggest thing in the world, and we get caught up in our own small world, but hey, at the end of the day, we're racing dirt bikes, and we can't forget why we're doing that.
Right. Because, you know, an actual AMA Arenacross, to go and do an entire series, it costs a lot. And, you know, to have everything included, and even a small race team, right? And for them to completely build a team pretty much just around you, has got to be a very good feeling. And even after you said, after, you know, whenever the candle is not lit anymore, whenever that time comes, you know, they still may be racing and, you know, doing these arena crosses and having this small team, and it would have never started if it wasn't for you. So I think that that's actually a really cool story.
Yeah, and you know, like you're saying, you never know what that can lead to or what kind of different role I can play as we start bringing more younger guys through the team. If we can keep it going and, you know, keep growing the name, keep growing our team, and just keep putting results in and just keep showing that we're there for the right reason.
Yeah, absolutely. You doing Atlanta and you're doing some other East Coast Supercross rounds this year?
Yep, that's the plan. We're going to Atlanta Supercross, New York City, and Nashville Supercross. And beyond that, we're not really sure yet. We're going to see how those go. But we're going in with no expectation, no pressure.
Right.
Obviously, myself, I have certain expectations that I think I should do or where I should be. But I'm trying to go in open-minded. You know, we weren't really training for Supercross, but we just want to go in and throw our leg in there and see how we do. And yeah, hopefully it goes smooth. I definitely like to make the mains, but Supercross is definitely a different animal, and those boys are fast.
Yeah, no kidding. And I remember we talked last year in Atlanta as well, so it'll be good for you to go there again. Any local racing that you've thought about doing after Supercross is finished, or really, I guess, what's really next after Supercross is done?
You know, I'd love to try. I'm trying to get my foot in the door, maybe with some World Supercross, but that seems to be pretty tough with all the teams kind of locked up. But I'd like to be able to do some World Supercross stuff.
Right.
But other than that, man, just local. We might try to bounce around and do a couple money races here and there. And we are talking about doing a few rounds of outdoors also, just to keep my fitness levels there throughout the summer. Something I haven't done. I haven't done since, I believe, 2018.
Yeah.
And I usually only did, like, Muddy Creek or something that would come around. I'd do, like, one or two.
Yeah.
But I think we might try to do 18. Buds or...
You did High Point in 18, right?
I believe so. It's
yeah.
16 or 17 and 18, I did a couple nationals here and there.
Yeah, yeah.
And
no,
we're trying to get back in that. And I was telling you guys, I just want to stay on the bike a little bit and do some nationals and mix it up with the boys and kind of keep my name relevant.
Yeah, no, that would be good. Heavy D, any last thoughts? We'll let Kyle get back to the bike night there.
No, I'm good, man. I'm excited to talk to him. You know, I'm pumped. He got second in 2024, dude. I feel 2024 this year, so I'm excited for him. And yeah, I'm rooting for him, the underdog, bro.
Yeah, man, rooting for the underdog, man. Hey, I tried to get that pre-race interview for you after Salem, but you were gone like a ghost. You were gone.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, I understand. So but no, man, hey, I appreciate it a lot. I'll see you in Atlanta, and man, I'll see you at some more races throughout the year, and I'm stoked for you, and I'm glad to see where you're at, because I remember that little slump that you were in and you know, all of that. So I'm glad to see where you're at, and I'm glad to see you have a team that's backing you, and you're back on a better motorcycle and all of that. So I'll see you in Atlanta, and I appreciate it again.
Yeah, absolutely, guys. Appreciate you guys having me on here, and you guys take care, and we'll see you at ATL.
All right, sounds good, Kyle. Appreciate you.
See you guys.
Later. And that was Kyle Bitterman on the Imperative MX podcast, episode number 21. And man, that was a good one, Heavy D. And Kyle, man, he's such a good guy. He's such a good, genuine guy, huh?
Oh, dude, super nice. Like, I tell you, you can go up, talk to him, and he will speak to you like he's known you his whole life. You'd never know.
Oh, I'm telling you.
He wouldn't.
That's why I like the underdog. Right. That's why I'm such a big fan of the underdog, man. He'll go and talk to anybody. I've seen kids go up to him, and he'll talk to him and almost missed his moto. You know, like, he's just that guy.
Super nice dude, man. Like, he's hard not to like.
Yeah, I don't know how anybody really couldn't like Kyle Bitterman for sure. Hydropower is formulated by a sports nutritionist to help eliminate arm pump and increase your endurance so you can ride safer and faster. Make sure to go and get your Blue Raz today at drinkhydropower.com. The link is in the description of this podcast for 10% off of your purchase of any of the hydropower products. And Heavy D first got his taste of some hydropower up there in the announcer's tower this weekend at the Ridge. How'd you feel, Heavy D?
Dude, I'm not going to lie to you. I mean, I'm not just saying this just because it's like the pod, but I could actually tell a difference. Like when I had it Saturday and when I didn't have any Sunday, it was like a big difference. Like Saturday, I felt like I could talk forever. Like
I just felt energized.
I felt refreshed, dude. It's actually, I see why everybody drinks it. It's legit.
Yeah, no, that stuff definitely is legit, and it did help me out there. I rode the banana on Saturday, so I did ride.
Oh, I know
I just didn't race, but I did ride. It was a little muddy at first, but hey, I did ride, and it did help with the arm pump and all of that the second time I went around by drinking some hydropower in between the first and second rides. So, man, I love the flavor. What'd you think about the flavor, Heavy D? Rate it on a scale of 1 to 10. How was the flavor?
Honestly, like the flavor, I'd give it about a 9. I'd give it a 9.
All right. Hey, I got to get you a full bottle because I didn't have a whole lot to give you. But on the next go-round, I'm going to get you a full bottle with a full amount in there. We'll get it all shaked up real good for you. Let you try it. Let you get the real complete flavor because that one might have been about half of what you really needed, Heavy D. So
yeah, it was only half full. I can't really judge it based off that.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I do like the flavor. It's got like a killer flavor to it.
Oh, it does. Yeah, no, that Blue Raz, if you want to go and get some, 9 out of 10 by Heavy D. So it's got to be good. Heavy D, you know, everybody knows that knows Heavy D knows. That's a tongue twister. Knows that Heavy D knows his food and his drinks. So,
oh, absolutely.
If he says that it's good, well, gosh darn it, it's good. Okay? So, make sure to go and check out. Yeah. Go and check out drinkhydropower.com. Get your Blue Raz today. Like I said, the link is in the description of this podcast for 10% off of your purchase of any hydropower products. FXR, we just had Kyle Bitterman on, and he runs FXR. From high-performance snow rider wear to motocross gear, FXR has you covered. The continuing growth of FXR means more selection for you. Jackets, jerseys, pants, gloves, snow gear, motocross gear, whatever you need, FXR has you covered. In my opinion, also in Garrett Marchbank's opinion, in, man, we can go local, Austin Webb's opinion, we can even go more local and go Jed Drye's opinion. Man, it is the best in sizing, fitting, and venting for motocross riding gear. So make sure to go and check out fxrracing.com. Find them on social media as well. Thanks for their continuing support, and we'll get to see the number 6 machine, Club MX FXR rider out there this weekend in Glendale. Actually, I'm sorry. It will be Enzo Lopes. I'm sorry. We're going to Glendale, Arizona. So it will be the West Coast, and we will see Enzo Lopes this weekend running some FXR along with some other riders as well. Total Control Racing Suspension. Man, it doesn't get much local, more local than Chad Newton. He owned an Arenacross team for 10-plus years. He knows his stuff. Luke Neese, Mike McDade, Tyler Bright, Josh Thomas, Jim Chester, Jim Neese, Luke Neese, and so many other legends throughout the years he has helped with their suspension. Make sure to go and check out Chad at Total Control. And thank you for them coming on board in 2023, keeping it really, really local with Total Control. And I tell you what, Heavy D, if you listeners have not changed your fork tube oil or adjusted your shock or have done anything to your suspension since you have gotten your motorcycle, you need to go and do that real fast.
Yeah. You don't, it'd be like water up in them units.
Yeah, you don't want that muddy, crappy, brown looking like used oil from 93 when I was born. You want that stuff to be crisp, and make sure you go and get it serviced. So go and check out Total Control Racing Suspensions. That's totalcontrolsuspension.com. Check Chad out, and appreciate Chad for doing everything that he does for Imperative MX and Silver Valley MX Park Heavy D. The NCMX round number 4 this weekend is canceled, unfortunately, but tell us a little bit about the local national.
The gnarliest, roughest, biggest track just out there, period. The only local national. Like, you know, I had somebody, I didn't, but I was on Facebook, and somebody put in, like, the club in CMX form, they asked, what is the closest track, or is there any track in North Carolina, South Carolina, close to Unadilla? So, me personally, I'm like, okay, Unadilla, no. Probably the closest thing is the Ridge.
Yep.
Jebediah said that, which is probably true. I mean, far as like old school natural terrain flow, yeah, but like, I just felt like, you know, Unadilla is a one of a kind track. Like, it literally just flows with the natural terrain. It's like, it's a unique track.
Yep.
But I was like, yeah, no, but if you're looking for a true like amateur or outdoor national style, like the just the roughness, the gnarliness, like that whole shebang, then Silver Valley, not Silver Dollar. I'm sorry, I don't know why I was thinking this and that.
Oh,
but Silver Valley is it.
Oh, Silver Valley is one of the gnarliest tracks I've ever rode in my life, and it flows so well. Once you get into that flow and you get into that groove, man, it feels so awesome from, you know, from a young rider all the way up. You don't even have to do all of the big jumps, but once you find a flow, you can find a good rut in every single corner, and you can flow all the way around the track. It is like none other. And yeah, Heavy D, just there's really nothing else to say other than the only local national.
Yeah, you got that right. Only local national.
Hey, I tell you what, keeping it local, and let's keep it even more local, and let's get the local legend, Jed Drye, on the phone. Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. For over 10 years, they've designed, manufactured, and marketed the highest quality dirt bike graphics and decals to the motocross and consumer markets. Their high-quality decals are considered by many to be the best in the industry. The awesome graphics and decals are utilized by professionals and weekend warriors alike. The highly acclaimed design team is well-equipped to help their customers get the design they want in a short amount of time. The design team provides itself on creativity, collaboration. Not only do they offer superior quality decals and top-notch designs, but at affordable prices at any budget. And that's what Dirt Industries Custom Graphics does for you guys, the listeners, and myself, and even Jed Drye from this weekend. And we do have a local legend here on the Imperative MX podcast, episode number 21, Jed Drye. What is going on, Jebediah?
Not much. Just another Wednesday, another work day, trying to get ready for the weekend.
I hear you on that. And, man, you and the crew got together in, I would say, about January, and correct me if I'm wrong, about the Ridge, or as known as Devil's Ridge, the iconic motocross track in Sanford, North Carolina, that me and yourself pretty much started, it seems like, our career in racing and just motocross in general. Talk to me a little bit about that and kind of the everything moving up until this weekend and the work that you guys did, because you guys did a phenomenal job with everything.
Yeah, I appreciate that. It was neat because I've been racing Devil's Ridge, or, you know, now the Ridge. I've been racing there since 94. And Mark Chess from NCMP, him and Mike Farr got together and met the owners now. And they proposed the opportunity to open the track back up. And, you know, as soon as Mark called me, I was like, yeah, of course. I would love to get my hands on Devil's Ridge, you know, because we've all raced there our whole life. And it's always needed some changes, but we've always had a good time there. So it's cool to see it back on the schedule. And you know, we opened up first of the year. We did a soft opening, which wasn't much soft about it. There was like 250 riders on a Sunday, so it was pretty gnarly. I'd say it was a great opening day for the Ridge. So
yeah,
that was, you know, pretty neat to see it back in action with that many riders, of course.
Yeah, no kidding. And man, leading up to the weekend, and how much view that you guys, you know, that you guys cleared out in the trees, and even after the finish line going down straight, I liked that so much better. And did you have any say on any of the obstacles or the way that you guys made anything? Did you have some say in some of that, and was able to work with them about how some of the sections were going to come about?
Yeah, of course. I mean, me and Mark, you know, when we get together, it doesn't take much. We get to chit-chatting a little bit about what would work best for what area. And, you know, usually when I build a track, I try to look around for what we have for drainage and try to base everything upon what the land is like already. So, you know, depending on what obstacles will work best in what areas is what we try to aim for. So it wasn't hard to find a good vision on the track, because we didn't want to change a lot, because it's one of the old school style tracks in our state. So
yeah,
we wanted to keep the old school feel, but, you know, pump it up a little bit, put some jumps in there, give you a little bit of time to breathe, and give the spectators a better viewing area. So that's why we had went back to the whole shot corner and tried to add that section, that new section in, to just give the crowd something to watch. You know, they can be trackside, and it just looks better all around. You know, it's cleaned up. There's a lot of work been done on the infield. Was more of a mess than the track was, I would say.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I was about to say, because, I mean, I'm sure that probably a dozer hasn't gone through some of that stuff since 1979. So,
but yeah, and there was more tires than I've ever imagined seeing in the track. You know, I never thought there'd be 6,000 tires, but I think there was like 6,001 maybe.
Oh my gosh, that's unreal. And man, talk to me about the first time that you got to ride it after you guys kind of finished up with it. I saw a little bit of the video, and man, I bet you that probably had to feel good to be back on that iconic motocross track in North Carolina. Did you know that Mr. Cameron was the first track to bring AMA to North Carolina at Devil's Ridge, or at the Ridge?
Really? That's neat. I've heard that before, but I didn't know if that was a true statement or just, you know, something that had been said. But so yeah, I heard that was the original AMA motocross track from North Carolina. So that's neat to know that.
Yeah, Mark came up and told us right there on Saturday morning, right, Heavy D?
Yeah, when he told us that, I was like, dang, dude. Like,
yeah,
I didn't know that. It's like, this place is super iconic. So if I, you know, I was telling Zach, I was like, it's just, Devil's Ridge, the Ridge now is just one of those places, you know, it's like a historical site. It's just meant to be there. It ain't meant to be knocked down. None of that. It's meant to be right where it is.
Yeah, yeah. God's got his hand on it and says, hey, man, this place ain't moving. This place here ain't moving. And, man, it's awesome to see. And on Sunday, you got to ride the RMZ, and it was funny because on, I believe it was on Saturday, that you were looking at my bike after practice and we were chit-chatting a little bit, and you were like, man, I'm actually kind of thinking about one and I'd like to ride one. And sure enough, on Sunday, all the stars aligned and you got your opportunity to race it. So tell me about it. Tell me about from the moment that you hopped on it during practice and all the way up there until the end, and kind of from like the beginning, how you felt, and at the end, how'd you feel? And I guess kind of what are your thoughts now, because the bike's not set up for you, it's set up for me. So yeah, tell me about it a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, well, I was a mess anyway, because I was obviously there to work this weekend, and, you know, I try to help prep the tracks, and even in intermission I was prepping the track. So that comes first, and then racing comes second. And the battery was dead on my Honda Sunday morning, and I was in a hurry. So when I asked to ride the Suzuki, I didn't know what to suspect until I got on it. And you know, of course, I got two or three practice laps, and I thought it felt really good. I mean, it's a stable bike. It's got a really smooth power, which is nice, because it actually, you know, helps me out a little bit you know, if I get older, I can't hold on to the rocket ships like I used to. So
right.
The power was perfect. And it's funny, I actually hole shot it almost every moto that thing was up front. So
yeah.
It definitely has plenty of power. And I put my kicking boot on, you know, I had my Garnets on thinking I was going to have to really kick that thing over, but dude, it barely took any effort to start it. So I was very impressed by the bike, honestly. And it's kind of made me think about getting one just due to contingency and stuff like that. So being not set up for me, I felt pretty good on it. Yeah. I'd ride it again. You know?
I was about to say, I mean, we were watching the battles up in the tower, myself and Heavy D. You know, we did some announcing, so I know you heard us two idiots up there. You know, broadcasting and yelling for some 85 racing, which, hey, some of those 85 races were good this weekend, man. I was yelling at the top of my lungs. I'm surprised I didn't have a voice when I came back, but it stayed intact. And yeah, we were watching up there from the announcer's tower, and I was like, man, Jebediah looks like he is finding his flow on the banana out there. And yeah, man, it was really cool to see you out there on the bike and also the track too. The Imperative MX Podcast, episode number 21, local legend segment, brought to you by Dirt Industries Custom Graphics with Jed Drye. Heavy D.
Yeah, dude, it was funny. I was watching and I was telling Zach, I was like, dude, honestly, like, no matter what Jed hops on, he's going to ride the hell out of it. But even though it wasn't set up for you, it's crazy. I was like, dang, like, he's still running up front, like, and doing hella good. And that thing ain't even close to being set up for him. Like, I was just like, dang, so he must actually be comfortable on the bike.
I try to adapt to something as soon as I ride it. I figure out, you know, if it's depending on what the suspension does, I'll try to ride accordingly, you know, and figure it out as fast as possible. But if it's easy to figure out, then it's easy to ride, you know. So that was a bike that was pretty easy to ride and easy to figure out, and it didn't take much to run up front on it. But obviously, I feel like with a little setup, I could be just as fast on that as I would anything else. So definitely worth taking a gander at, being that the contingencies for NCMX series is pretty good on the Suzuki stuff.
So. Yeah, $150 a win, Jed.
I know. I could have made some money this weekend, maybe.
Yeah, you could. Yeah, you could have. What'd you think about the BF RC shock? I didn't change it. I told Chad to leave it alone because I honestly like the little bit of time that I've messed with it. I really like the shock absorber over the spring on the Suzuki. So far, was it different for you?
The shock felt good. I actually like the shock probably a little better than the forks, and the forks were good. They turned good. They were stable. I felt like I'm a really big front brake rider.
Yeah.
So I ride the front brakes a lot going into a corner, and I feel like I would get it a little further down the stroke than what I'm used to on maybe my Honda. But
yeah.
Honestly, throughout the day, I felt better and better and better as I rode it. So, and you know, Saturday I had a pretty good crash for an old man. I crashed actually my buddy's post-season. Yeah, I went end over end pretty good. So, I don't know if Sunday was really the best day to be racing for me, but you know, we made it happen. So, it worked out the best.
Hey, rider or racers race, man, racers race.
Yeah, I could not race, especially after, like you said, the track's iconic. I've always loved racing there because it's always been a good track to race on.
Yeah.
And the dirt's not comparable to anything else. It's actually one of the tracks that still has a lot of really good dirt left on it. So
yeah, no,
I was looking forward to getting in it.
Yeah, no, the dirt is one of the best. I think really the only real problem was the tabletop in the middle was probably the biggest concern. Other than the start being really dry those couple of years when they had like a regional and an area there, but that tabletop and the kicker, that was probably the biggest issue there on the track was some of the faces. And this weekend, we only had that one that happened, or that kicker that was on the finish line there, but you guys were quick to go back and fix it, and you know, everything was good. And it was just from the softness of the rain that happened on Saturday, But overall, that track is so good, and I think it, even for the little guys, it is a great track for, you know, ruts and, you know, gnarly breaking bumps and some jumps and all of that. I mean, you know, there were so many good riders out there, and yeah, the track's super iconic, and you know, we've been racing it, you said, since 94. And Jed, just to let you know, I was born in 93, bro.
So, how was you? Yeah. You're a little younger than me, huh?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm not far behind you. Wait, how old are, when were you born? Or how old are you?
90.
Oh, okay.
90.
So, oh, okay.
32 years.
Oh, okay. Okay. So you're not too far in front of me, but I'm catching up. So,
yeah, you're catching up.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Heavy D.
How old are you,
yeah,
Heavy
D? Say it again.
How old are you?
I'm 28.
28. Okay.
Which is crazy to believe. I swear it seemed just like yesterday. I was only like 15, but now I'm 28.
Yeah,
got kids. Oh, dude, that's what like I was. We was saying, like, when we was announcing, I was like, dude, once you hit 125s, time starts to go by quick.
Oh yeah, it does. And especially just racing. I mean, racing is a different world for people that don't do it. They don't understand, you know, for an average racer, if you race, you know, pretty often, then your weeks go by fast, your weekends go by fast, and time just goes by because you're always chasing the race, you know. So you don't really pay attention to everything during the week or slow down. You stay busy so you can get there on the weekend, and then, you know, that comes and goes pretty quick too. So time does fly by.
No, you're right about that. Like, now I see why, like, a lot of the older racers, you know, the vet guys, which I can't really say, I'd be a vet guy now, but it's like, they say, like, enjoy it, because, like you say, when you're working during the week, to go ride during the week, and you look forward to it, that shit flies by so fast. So, like, it's like all the moments you take for granted are, like, the moments you get pissed off about, hate, dude, enjoy them. Like, as much as possible, because it flies by. It goes by in a blink.
Yeah, it was good to see you guys out there this weekend. And honestly, being the first race back, having good announcers makes a big difference. So it was awesome to have two good announcers. You guys, you did a killer job. And there was a few times I could hear you through my helmet while I was racing. So the Suzuki exhaust was nice and quiet, too. I like that. It's not too loud.
Yeah. But,
no, it was good, man. Like, me and Zach, we've been, you know, when I met Zach, you were actually living in Sanford.
Yep.
So the Ridge was your local track, you know.
Yeah, well, here's a funny fact for you if you didn't hear it. First ever AMA race was at the Ridge, and the first ever time I ever announced was, what, 22 years later at the exact same place. So
really?
Yeah.
So that was your first day announcing?
That was my first ever time announcing.
Really? That was awesome.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah,
so
you did a good job.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Yeah, yeah, I appreciate that. Did you ever
hear more memories?
Did you hear any of the intermission whenever I know that you were dealing with the track a little bit there, but did you hear any of the intermission talk that we had?
Remind me, what was it about?
We were just talking pretty much just about local racing and stuff, right, Heavy D?
I think I was listening to that for a little bit, because before I got on the tractor, I was washing my bike, or washing your bike, and getting it cleaned up. So, yeah, I remember I was listening, and I heard y'all talking about local racing and local legends and stuff like that, but I didn't hear too much of it. I was pretty busy, so.
Yeah. What keeps you going, Jed? Like, what keeps you coming back to these local motocross races and you know, designing these tracks and helping track promoters and all of that? Like, you've been in it for so long, right? But what really is, like, the reason why you keep coming back and keep doing it year after year after year? Because I mean, you may have had like one or two years that I know of that you might have kind of stopped or didn't ride for a little bit, but I feel like you've just always been here in the sport, in this District 29 NCMX area, pretty much damn near your entire life.
Yeah, I've stayed pretty local. I mean, I was actually talking to little Timmy Phillip earlier on the way home from work. We were talking about, you know, traveling around and doing some racing, and And I have a few spurts where I like to travel and go hit some pro-ams and different races, but to me, just the local scene is so, I don't know, it's just a very happy place to be. The people at our local races, at the NCMAC series, they're always just a joy to be around. It's a fun place to be. And the older I get, the more that I realize that's, you know, that's my extended family and that's the place I want to be. And watching the kids race and stuff, you know, I like to give back. And just like Heavy D and yourself, you know, you want to give back to the sport. And being able to make a dollar or work in the industry, whatever keeps you, you know, that's what keeps me going. It's just like the kids and being able to do something in the industry. And, you know, I've always been on equipment. So I guess my niche was designing tracks and doing that. So it's just something I wouldn't really change it for anything, because I've done a lot of stuff and I always go back to the same local racing and trying to help out the local scene as much as I can, especially with the kids and stuff. Because I remember being a kid and there's certain tracks I would have loved to see a change every now and then. And, you know, a lot of the track owners just didn't do a lot with them. So we went, you know, 5 or 10 years riding the exact same layout. So it's neat to change it up and be able to be a part of that and keep people excited about coming back. So that's kind of why I like to stay around, because I want to see the new faces and see people show up every year and be excited about riding dirt bikes, because that's what I've always done, you know?
Yeah, and that's, I mean, you literally hit the nail on the head with pretty much everything on why myself and Heavy D created this podcast. It's just for that exact reason, to grow the sport. I mean, how cool would it have been in the early 2000s for somebody to have a podcast talking about the race that we literally just went to, you know? Yep. Like, and talk about everything that went down and behind the scenes and, you know, all of this stuff. Like, you know, that's the whole reason that I wanted to do it. And another reason too is as we get older, right? Like, you know, life hits us with certain things, right? And, you know, you get a little bit of confidence and motivation and even just some gratification just being at these races, right? Because we're older, right? And myself and you, yep, right, we're good on dirt bikes, and we've had a good career on dirt bikes, right? But me and yourself, we're not cocky about it, and we don't honestly probably don't even really even want to talk about it. But at the same time,
yeah, I really don't care too much. But
yeah, and I'm kind of the same way. Heavy D can attest. Like, I'd much rather talk about everybody else than myself. But Heavy D just wants to blow me out. But whatever, it'll be all right. So, but man, when the kids come up and they're excited to talk to you, and you just see in their eyes like they're looking at Batman or they're looking at like one of their superheroes or something like that, like, I think that that's cool. Because myself, like, I don't know, like, you know, pick a, you know, a local legend that we grew up with, right? And going to go watch them ride. And if we got to talk to them for like 2 or 3 minutes, like, dude, that was awesome to us. Like, I can't believe that Futrell talked to me on the line before the gate dropped, or, you know, whatever the case may be, right? Like, but now we're almost in their shoes, you know? So it's,
yeah.
So it's cool to give back to the community, like you said, and I guess that was kind of a different example of that. But, man, I feel like the local community needed something different, and I feel like the NCMX series and, you know, District 13 and all of that is getting something different with all of us that really have been in the sport for quite a while, with Charlie Forge from PR Motorsports to you doing all of the track design and track promotions, and Heavy D with his track building and him helping me here on the podcast, and then myself. Like, there's a lot more people, obviously, but just here in the group, like, it's cool to see that we all have the same vibe and the same feeling towards this sport, because I don't think that we would be the same person that we are today if we didn't have the local motocross scene kind of in our blood and what we want to do, right? So,
no, I mean, absolutely not. Like, I agree 100% on that. And that's, you know, we're, like you said earlier, we're not old, but we're older and we have knowledge. You know, we're knowledgeable about the sport. We're knowledgeable about the tracks, and just knowledgeable in general about the motocross scene in general. So it's nice to give that knowledge back to, whether it's a new guy coming up, a kid. You know, I got friends from the military that race now that just started, and, you know, I try to help them out with bike maintenance or teach them how to do air footers properly. Just basic knowledge, you know, and just giving, that's giving back. And that's something that for the rest of their life, don't know how to do an air filter or know how to tighten their chain correctly, or might even know some tech tips on riding. You know, it's just whatever I can give back to help somebody else. You know, because we all know, you remember being a kid and bikes blowing up, or learning the hard way, as you know, my dad would say it. And we learned the hard way. So it's kind of nice to be able to help other people not have to go that route and save some money, because it is expensive. But
yeah, for sure.
Just for the track building thing, I mean, it's something that I never thought I'd be doing probably 15 years ago. I would have not guessed I was building tracks locally for the races, you know, that we're going to be racing on. So it's neat how opportunities do come about. And like, same thing with you guys. Like, I never thought, I've known Heavy D for a long time. Never would I thought he'd be on the dozer building the jumps that we're jumping and riding, you know?
But, me either.
Me neither.
There he is. He's in there, yeah.
Yeah.
I never thought Heavy D would be as quiet as he is tonight either. You know, that's a little different.
I know.
No, it's funny just because, like, you know, like, just I've known Jeff for a long time, you know. I've been around Zach a lot. I watched Zach race a lot. It's funny, we didn't, like, you know, really talk until later on. It's like the crazy thing, you meet these people in racing, and, like, you got a lot you hang out with and you know of, and then it's like you become good buddies with them. But, like, you know, I grew up around you. I grew up watching you. It's like, I think it's cool. Like, now it's like, you know, a lot of knowledge I learned from you. I learned from a lot of different guys. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, So like, for me now, like, yeah, I think it is pretty rad. Like, I learned to run a dozer at that, you know, young age, you know, equipment and stuff. And now I do get to build tracks, which is pretty sweet. But, like, even for riding, like, I mean, I race C-class. I mean, I felt like I was decent, wasn't great. But I think, for me, it's pretty crazy now because I learned a lot, and like you say, it's passing on that knowledge. It's a lot more weird for me because I was that kid taking in all the knowledge, and you know, I still use it to this day, but passing it on, it's a bit weird. It's just a sign that I'm getting old, I guess.
Nice. Yeah, we all are. But at the same time, I mean, and that's, you know, Zach says back to him saying, why do I keep coming back? And that's, you know, I feel pretty young to be my age in a sense of when I go racing. You know, I've taught these kids, you know, especially like the 50 riders, when my helmet's on, I'm not the exact same Jed Drye anymore.
Yeah.
I'm a very chill, humble guy in the pits. And, like, you know, I'm stoked to be there, and I'm happy, try to be as happy as possible. But when my helmet's on, I'm there to race. Like, I'm stoked to race, and I don't think about being out of shape. I don't think about my back hurting. You know, I don't think about none of that. Like, when the helmet's on, it's, you know, that's, I'm a superhero in a sense. You know, yeah, that's my alter ego.
Yeah,
I'm a racer.
Yep,
you know, and that's just how it is. So I feel like if I take the helmet off and leave it off too long, then I'll probably just turn into an old man. So
that's honestly,
I keep coming back every weekend.
You honestly hit that nail on the head, damn near perfect. Because I've tried to, like, figure out for myself, and you're right. Like, as soon as, because for myself, like, I know that I am out of shape. I got humbled by Kendrick and Forbes at Birch Creek like two or three weekends ago. And I was like, oh my God, dude, I came off the track. I was pissed. I was like, no way. Like, you know, like, no offense to them. Maybe they were riding great. You know what I'm saying? But for my entire life, I've pretty much beat them, you know, and for that to happen and I just blow up in like a lap and a half, I was so mad, you know. But 5 minutes later, you give me a second, and I'm, you know, I'm happy-go-lucky, my same self. But you're right. Like, as soon as you put on the helmet, it is a different animal and a different beast. But, yeah, when you come off the track, I mean, it's all good. Everybody's having a good time. Like, yeah. Like,
oh, yeah. I mean, that's a racer mentality. I mean, it wouldn't – if you didn't have that mentality, you wouldn't necessarily be 100% of a racer, because I feel like that's just the way it's supposed to be. When you put the helmet on, you know, you don't want to be cocky, but you want to be confident, because we're doing something that's pretty technical. So if you don't have the confidence to do it, or if when you put your helmet on, you're not in the zone you need to be in to go out there and perform, then it's hard to perform, you know?
Yep.
So
exactly.
But sometimes, you know, I tell people, I'm like, dude, I get beat up with my helmet on, because I'm a big guy with my helmet on. You know, I get on the track, I'm like, man, I'm ready to go. And then I get to battling with somebody that's 220, 6'4", and I'm like, man, that's a big dude. And I just ran for him.
You but,
I try to hurry up and take my helmet off. I'm like, all right, go back to regular Jed. Hey, man, sorry.
I thought about that.
Yeah, but out on the track, man. I'm like showing fake muscles and, you know, all pumped up. But
I'm a small guy when the helmet comes off. Yeah.
I try to hurry. I've actually done that, man. I'll never forget being at Muddy Creek, and I was battling with a guy named Jonathan Foskey. He was a big boy, and he was fast. And, man, he hit me pretty hard, and I got pretty pissed about it. So when we pulled off, you know, you hook a right and pull off at Muddy Creek. And as soon as we pulled off, I ran into his rear tire, and I was like, hey, man, you know who you're messing with? And he dropped his bike and stood up, and I was like, you rode good. You did good, man. I was like, holy cow, he would have killed me. Like, what was I thinking?
He said, yeah, I'm going back to the truck.
Yeah, I aborted that mission really fast. I was like, abort mission.
Push the eject button. Yeah, let me soar out of here. Speaking of local legends, Jed, who is your local legend that was just balls fast at the racetrack that you looked up to, you know, before you got on big bikes, and each time you saw them, you were just in amazement? Who was that local legend when you think about it?
I say I had a few local legends. I mean, Tyler Bright was a good friend of mine when I was younger, and even though we're same age, Tyler excelled, you know, early at 16, 17, 18. He was a Arenacross, Supercross, and trying his best to make it to the ranks, which was neat because I hung out with Tyler, and he was one of the guys who accepted me as just a local C rider, kind of, you know.
Yep.
He would show me about his gym routine.
I think everybody accepted you, though, Jed, right? Like, there wasn't many people that, I mean, because I was around Bean and Zimmer and, like, all of those, right? And you were a little bit older, but I think everybody still respected you.
Yeah, they did. I mean, they did. I never really had anybody that was, like, super mean. I remember a couple kids, you know, obviously boys are boys and kids would pick around and talk junk, and that's how it would be every now and then, but for the most part, that's why I still come to the track, because everybody is so cool. They always have been. But Tyler Bright was one that he was just such a hard worker to earn his spot in racing, which is something that, you know, you someone who's local legend. You know, to me, that's a legend for sure, because he put a lot of work behind it.
Yep.
But then I also had guys that I hung out with that were the opposite. They were not. They didn't train. They didn't do nothing. They were just fast. Like Cody Robbins back in the day. He was a kid that he could wake up at 12 o'clock and go ride at 12:30 and be the fastest kid at the track. Yep. I don't know how, but just, you know, there's different people. So I had different influences, but it's cool because I've seen so many different influences, and I realized, like, right then, hey, some people have it, some people don't.
Yep.
But if you really want it, you put in the work. So if you do have it a little bit, you put in that work and you're going to have it, you know, because I watched, like, Tyler Bright, he's never threw a whip.
No.
He's never threw a whip in his life.
No.
But he's won a race. You know, dude, he's a race champion. You know,
he's a champion. TB.
You're right about that.
TB.
He's never threw a tail whip.
Unreal. Never.
I've never seen him do it before.
You know, Jim and Tickle and all of them were up there in Greensboro one day out there on the Arenacross track catapult trying to teach him how to whip. And he looked like he was not, straight up and down.
Like a
stale
fish, yeah.
Dude, so stale, but somehow it freaking worked.
he was the kind of guy that he trained so hard and he did things right, and I loved hanging out with him because he was a motivator to me, and he was a local legend for sure, because like I said, he did all that at a young age, and I don't think people realize, but, you know, at 18, he was up there. He was racing Supercross and outdoors.
Yep.
You know, he was going to college in his 20s, which is neat. Pretty neat lifestyle he did, and I got a lot of respect for that guy. So
We crowned him our first podcast that we had. We crowned him as the local legend. Like, he is like the epiphany of a local legend for the reasons.
Well, that's his middle name, Tyler Local Bright.
pretty much. So yeah, he's got the crown of everybody just because of what you talked about, right? Like, his, you know, just throughout his amateur career and all of that, and he even accepted me, and I was really, really young, you know what I'm saying? But I was able to hang out with him up there in the stands and AMA Arenacrosses when he was winning and, like, all of that. And, man, his parents were so nice at the racetracks, and man, I'll never forget those Windy Hill, Rolling Hills battles. You know, he would be right up there with Futrell and them, and you look at him, and it doesn't look like he's really doing anything because he's just so stale and just, like, I wouldn't even call his technique even being perfect because elbows were a little iffy sometimes. But at the end of the day, he got it done. And in racing, it doesn't matter. He got it done. And, man, he definitely...
Yeah, I mean, he was a very good rider. He worked hard. Like I said, he worked hard for it. So that was a neat thing to grow up watching. And he was always, like I said, he accepted everybody. And his family was cool. So he's a local legend for sure, which North Carolina is hard, man. There's so many people that come from here.
Yeah.
That were fast.
It's unreal.
Dude, there's so many. I forgot about more people than I probably even know right now that were rippers and that were good people.
We could go through like pages and pages and pages of racers that have just come just from North Carolina that never got the spotlight that they deserved, and that's why, honestly, we do the local legend segment to do that, like yourself, right? Like, I don't believe really anybody else that would, you know, kind of put spotlight on guys that really didn't, you know, get the upbringing that they should have in the sport. But go ahead, Heavy D.
I was gonna say I can name one right now. I know Jed probably remembers him. Zach, you probably would too. You remember Zach Olivier?
Yep.
Oh yeah, I talked to him last. He came to Black Acorn Road about maybe three weeks ago, maybe when I rode there.
Really?
He was on a Lodge 1852 stroke. Yeah, man, it was so cool to see him. I was good buddies with Zach. He's a good dude. Humble
as dude, he could flat out get down on a dirt bike.
Yeah, he was an unknown guy. Nobody really knew who he was. Because he didn't do a lot of traveling. He was kind of a local guy, of course, but he could go to a regional and be one of the fastest guys there on 80 or on, you know, on mini bikes.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, he won a moto at Loretta's.
He did, didn't he?
Yeah, okay. He won a moto at Loretta's.
Yep. What? That was was that 11 or 10?
Who's that?
Yeah.
I would say that's probably before that, wouldn't it?
It was before that. I wouldn't even
like 2005, probably. Yeah, probably 4 or 5 when he was on mini bikes. But I know.
Oh,
yeah.
When he was on mini bikes. Oh, okay, okay,
yeah.
Okay.
I think probably in like a 12 to 13 class or something. He
okay. Yeah, he was a little bit older than I was. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he sent me close.
Yeah. It was. See, I hadn't even start. I didn't start riding though. 2006, 2007. I was around it in 2006. That's when I started to meet all y'all when Garrett and them opened up his track over there. That's when I met like Jed, Tyler, Aaron Whitfield, golly, it's so many more of them, like Dale Davis. The list.
There's a local. There's an old school local. Dale Davis.
Ron Smith. Like I met so many of them.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot that don't get the spotlight that they deserve. And yeah, from as many races and things that you know, we've seen, I mean, it's unreal. I mean, the Rolling Hills battles to me is what stands out. I don't know if there's like any real, like, is there a track that you miss seeing all the really good battles with, like a really, like probably that range of 04 to like 09, 2010 was a lot of fast guys. Like, at least maybe, like, I mean, in the 80s, we had JT and, you know, Cody Robbins, and we had Futrell, we had Smith, we had KP, we had Tickle there for a little bit. I mean, there was a lot of guys that came up. Cooper came up. I mean, there's a lot of guys that people don't know that came up through the ranks in this area. Or District,
and then you had the Balfour brothers. Like, they were always pretty good. Like, there was a bunch of people who don't race anymore that were still like decent. Like Travis Poole was fast on 80s, you know,
Josh Hall, like, dude, there's a lot of guys that were fast for sure.
Names down forever. You know, it's weird, we're in a sport that's like a very large but very small world.
Yes,
you know, it's a small world sport where everybody knows everybody, but it's also such a large sport. Like, there's a lot of people my speed or are going the same speed nowadays. I mean, you could have the top C riders, your top vet riders, and your mid-pack A riders, and your top B riders. Like, everybody's fast. There's a lot of fast people, you know. And it's always been that way with motocross, but people come and go, you know. So every year you'll see, like, a new guy come in or somebody, you know, disappears that don't show back up the next year. But it's always
I know Zach was saying, like, it would have been cool if it would have been a podcast or some talk about it back in the day, because everything that went down, like, Zach was just talking about a track that you would probably, what was a track that you would probably say that was sick and had a bunch of battles. And the one I always heard about, I never got to ride. The year they closed down is the year I started riding, and that was Parker Valley. And
Parker Valley.
So much sick stuff about Parker Valley.
Parker Valley was neat. There was a lot of battles, like you said. That track had some weird jumps. I wasn't a huge fan. Had a lot of little singles that went up the hills and stuff. It was, to me, just pointless. But for some reason, that track had the best racing of any track in that time period. Alessi Brothers, so many people showed up to them races at Parker Valley. And it was pretty intense racing all the time there. And that's back in the serious racewear time, too. So, like, I say it was big, but they were making the motivation videos and stuff. So,
yeah,
there was a lot of battles and a lot of fast people. I mean, Matt Bonney, Tyler Bright, Futrell, Les Smith. I can name just a ton of people that were all riding on that same team, in a sense. And they all, you know, the B-class and the schoolboy and the pro classes were always stacked with some fast people, always.
Every weekend. Every single weekend. Like, it didn't matter where we went. It was every... Do you remember that Myrtle Beach track that we went to that was all black sand? Jacksonville?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Dude.
Yeah, I remember those tracks. Jacksonville MX and Myrtle Beach Motorsports.
Dude, I just remember it being so hot, and we were down there, and I think Zimmer got his motorhome stuck, and we had to pull him out or something like that. And then, oh, man, that was one of the tracks. I think they only went only a handful of times, but we had the banquet down there too. And I know you went to some of those banquets, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I used to have more fun at the banquets than I did at the track.
Oh, I'm
Chef Langdon. Chef was so much fun to be around when he was not stressed out at the track, you know?
Yeah.
So,
Chef was such a good guy, man. Chef was such a good guy.
Yeah, he was. He kept motocross, so he tried his best to make motocross as good as he could. And it was funny because I didn't know, you know, when I was a little kid, I never knew exactly what he did or who he was, but I always seen him, and I always seen him smoking that corncob pipe.
Yep.
And yelling at people. I'm like, why is this old man always yelling at people and just smoking that pipe walking around the track? You know? And then I realized this man is running the series, and he's like, you know, he was the District 29 man. So over the years, I got to know him more and more, and he was helping me out as a kid, paid for me to ride an extra class because I could only ride one usually.
Yeah.
And he was just super, super cool. So, and that's, you know, everything goes back to, like you said earlier, why do I keep coming back? And same thing there. It's like, man, it's cool to see people like him, you know, and I kind of want to be the same way, in a sense of I care about the sport. So if I just let it go and take off away from it, I feel like it'll be a piece of me that the rest of my life I'll wonder, like, man, what would have happened if I'd have stuck around and kept building tracks or kept helping the kids? Or, you know, I feel like it would be a tough thing for me to get completely out of it. And it doesn't make sense, or it's not affordable for me to go outside of my local lifestyle, my local series. You know, it makes sense just to stay around here and rip dirt bikes for fun. And if Zach Newberry has a banana he needs me to peel it, I'll peel it, you know.
Absolutely, man. And man, it was good to have you on here, first time on the pod, and I know for sure it won't be the last. And myself and Heavy D have Don't worry. When we get a studio and it's me and him in a room and we get to talk back and forth, trust me, he won't be too quiet. But like we were actually kind of talking about in the announcer's booth, it's pretty hard to, I guess, really kind of see, you know, because you don't see the person, right? So, but when you have the person in front of you, you can kind of bring a little bit more to the table as far as talking and, you know, points and stuff like that. But, man, whenever we do get a studio, we're definitely going to have to get you down there and heavy on a pod for sure. But hey, I do appreciate you and the entire Ridge MX crew on bringing a phenomenal track back, and what a return this weekend in Sanford, North Carolina. So, Jed, I appreciate it, man. You're a local legend, and in my eyes, especially after this interview and knowing, getting to know you more, and I know the listeners are going to greatly appreciate it. So, thanks a lot for coming on, Jed.
Oh, thank you guys, man. It means a lot for you to give me a call and allow me to be on here, and I appreciate what you did this weekend. And now we just got to have a we got to plan an Imperative MX party / ride day, right?
Yeah, man. We're working on it, and I'll keep you in the loop.
Sounds good, guys. Y'all take care. Thanks, Heavy D.
And you know it, Jed.
All right. Yep. Later.
Until next time. Later.
And that was the local legend, Jed Drye, here on the Imperative MX podcast, episode number 21, brought to you by the amazing people over there at Dirt Industries Custom Graphics. Man, Heavy D, Jed, what a guy. What a guy.
Dude, a full legend, bro. I remember coming into the sport, dude, like, when we first, like, got my bike, my KX100s, like, any race we was at, he'd always come over and hang up, chat it up with my dad, and like, dude, give like good pointers on what we could do to make the bike better, or like something wasn't right. He's like, hey, dude, you did this, it probably helped out a lot. Like, that's just the kind of guy he is. He's always looking to help and, you know, being involved, and it shows. Like, he's somebody that's like good for the sport, man. And also the younger generation. He's somebody you can always learn something from.
No, absolutely. And He's such a good guy, and I mean, I learned probably more than I have in the years that I've known him, just in that 45-minute conversation or however long we had him, or you know, on this episode here. And man, he does it for the right reasons, and it's good to see that. And when he brought up the Shep Langdon, and remember him walking around and yelling at people, man, I remember that, but I remember him being the face of the District 29 series, and it's cool that we kind of looked at him the same and, you know, gave him authority and all of that. And with the Ridge and the MX, the Ridge MX return this weekend, and amazing battles from the Super Mini class all the way down to the Shaft class, all the way to the 30+, man, there was a lot of good racing this weekend. And other than that, Heavy D, I just wanted to thank everybody that came up to the announcer's tower, talked to us, the entire crew in CMX, the entire Ridge MX, everybody that was associated that came out, whether you were a spectator or a racer or a parent or a, you know, a sister-in-law of a racer or whatever, you know, reasoning that you were there at the racetrack this weekend. Myself and Heavy D definitely do appreciate it. And man, I feel like the local scene is in a good spot right now, Heavy D.
Oh, 100%, like you said. Definitely. Well, once again, thank you to everybody. But dude, the local scene is awesome. Like, the battles that was going on, the atmosphere, like, dude, that's how, like, local racing should be. Like, you know, it should be, like, it don't matter where you are in the sport, if you're a top amateur or, you know, somebody who's just getting into it. Like, I feel like if you come local race, it helps out so much on both ends. Like, you're not going to get anything bad out of local racing. I mean, that's where it starts. Like I always say, that's where you learn your racecraft. Like, that's what keeps it fun. Like, you know, I remember my dad, he told me, it's funny, he said, when I first started, he was like, you know, we didn't get to ride 50s, you didn't ride 60s, you're on an 80. He said, and in this sport, you can, you know, there's so many different levels of it, and what you do and how you want to do it, it's different outcomes. He's like, you know, if you just want to go race local and have fun, you know, he said, it's just a fun thing. He said, you can progress racing local. He said, nothing wrong with that. He said, you'll get real good if you do local. He said, if you want to go race nationals, you
got to get even better. He was like, but the thing is, if you want to race nationals, he said, practicing is going to be fun. He said, but it's going to be hard.
Yep.
When we go race local, he said, it'll be fun, but it's going to be even harder because when you go to the national level, you don't want to lose at a local level. He said, but when you go to a national, he said, it's going to freaking suck because you work so hard to get there and you work to go win. You don't work to get second, you work to go win at that level.
Yeah.
He was like, so trust me. He always told me, we can do that, but I'm telling you, son, you just, local is where it's where your heart will be. And sure enough, the other day, local racing is where my heart is because I've been there, I've done that high level stuff. So have you. And he wasn't lying to me. It was some of the best knowledge I had. Not shying anybody else away from it, but if you get up to that level, it does get stressful and it really starts to take the reason you started racing motocross away, which is the fun in my opinion. So, I mean, go local racing. It brings memories and it'll keep you in it for a long period of time. Like yourself, Jed, myself, you know, I think that's just where local racing, that's why it's so great.
Yeah, no, local racing is the heartbeat that pumps all the blood into all of the racing that we get to watch professionally and really just keeps all of these people that come to the racetrack because they love the same sport that we do. That's what keeps them going and, you know, allows these vendors and these sponsors and everybody to get together to run a successful series throughout the year with a great banquet. And I'm not even speaking just for NCMX. I'm speaking of the series that are around the area that we know. Man, they all do a phenomenal job, in my opinion. And, man, Heavy D, before we end this episode, we do have the next topic of the AMA Supercross Championship, Monster Energy, AMA Supercross brought to you by Monster Energy, Supercross 6 brought to you by Monster Energy Supercross. So, but it's a clean slate right now, Heavy D, between the two title contenders, Eli Tomac and Cooper Webb. This, honestly, is unbelievable.
Hold on. What do you mean it's a clean slate?
It's a clean slate. They're tied. They're tied in points. It's like...
Yeah,
it's a clean slate. They're tied in points.
You had me throw it off for a minute. I thought you was about to say, like, a point reset. And I was about to say, hold on, did I miss something?
No. It might... I mean, shit, it might as well be by this point, you know? But... Man, like, going into this Triple Crown this weekend, Eli's good at them. Cooper is also good at them. Man, like, and Chase obviously is going to be fast. Can he keep it together for 20 laps and not fall over, right? That's going to be, you know, that's going to be the key. So we'll see what can happen there. But as far as the championship title goes, we're at round number 12 this weekend. We only have five more after this. So,
right.
Who do you have right now with this, you know, pretty much points at tied? With the remaining rounds coming up, who do you have as your pick for the title?
Oh, golly.
I know this is a hard question. I'll go ahead and give mine. I think Webb's going to do it. I was going to go Tomac there for a second, but I'm just going to go Webb. I think the mental battles and the confidence that he has right now after he shot down Chase in the heat race. Oh, did you miss that?
No, I've seen that.
Okay.
Part.
So after he shot Chase, and he's been playing mind games a little bit here, I think it may take over because Tomac hasn't had to deal with Webb yet, and Webb hasn't had to deal with Tomac yet in a title fight. But based off stats, Webb obviously gets better as the year goes. Tomac allowed Anderson to get, what, 6 straight wins last year at the end or whatever? But right. I know that he was in, yeah. You know, he was pretty far up in the championship ahead because of the bad couple races that Anderson had. I think Webb can get it done. But at the same time, I think that you can pretty much have an argument for both sides. I mean, this is going to be great.
Mm-hmm.
Who you picking, Heavy D? Who you got? Who you got? ET3 or CW2?
Dude, I got to go with the mental side, and I'm going CW2. And the reason is, I think he feels like this is possibly Tomac's last season, possibly, in Supercross. Mm-hmm. So he wants that right to say he beat him straight up.
Yep. I can see that as well.
That's where I'm going that route.
Yeah, I think just the mental strength is going to come into play really heavily here. And it may even start with Webb this weekend. So it will be really interesting to see what happens. But honestly, this is so good for the sport. It is awesome that we have these two guys, an amazing story, both of them 2 times champion, like you said. Tomac, this may be his last year. Can Webb kind of knock off the veteran of the sport and, you know, him, you know, take over, right? Man, this is going to be cool. I'm so excited going to Atlanta, going to New Jersey, and going to Nashville. So that will be good.
Oh, 100%. It's gonna be sweet, and I can't wait. Like, it's definitely gonna be a dog fight, but I just feel like Coop has it on his mind, man. I really do.
Yeah, no, for sure. And then, obviously, I don't really think there's really much else to talk about in the 450 class. We can go through each rider and do that. But for right now, with the episode that we had. And we're almost catching up on 2 hours here. But in the 250 class, we'll run through that. McAdoo came out today and said that he will not be racing, or not him, but the team came out and said that he will not be racing this weekend. He had a practice crash. So, unfortunately, the Pro Circuit Kawasaki luck is not going in their way, unfortunately. So, they will have – I do not think they will have a rider this weekend at the track, which is going to be a little crazy. So be on the lookout for that. But honestly, I didn't check to see if they have anybody else, so don't quote me on that. But I do know that McAdoo is not racing. And Jet, can the Lawrence brothers' streak of no Triple Crown wins be stopped this weekend in Glendale? Do you think Jet can get the overall and stop the Lawrence brothers' Triple Crown disaster from their eyes, pretty much, on Triple Crowns? Can he get it done this weekend, Heavy D?
Dude, it's going to be tough. It's going to be tough. Somebody's going to have to stop him, but. Dude, they're just too good right now. Honestly, they are.
Dude, they really are, right? So, it's going to be really interesting to see, because now, looking, right, you only have to think that RJ is going to be the guy that needs to kind of dethrone him and Kitchen, right? But Man, I mean, just looking at that, right? Jet's a step ahead of them. So it just can Jet not take himself out? Maybe the better question moving forward. Or do you think RJ? Yeah. Do you think RJ and Kitchen can maybe battle him? And you know, I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if, you know, they're able to come up on top, right? You know, after you know, if Jet were to have those mistakes, but if Jet pulls a hole shot, we don't think anybody is going to pass him and win, right?
No. Man, RJ's right there, but just the fact of passing him and beating him, that's gonna be a tough task. Like, RJ was up there, you know, you made a mistake. I feel like Pierce, if he gets up there, it'll be a different story. He just always, when he gets right there, it just seems to be, you know, darn, Jet gets right there.
Yeah.
He gets out front and he gets gone.
Right. Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I hope that we see not a boring three race main event for these guys in the 250 class. I hope somebody can get in there and make a race out of it. I want to see a race, and I want to see Jet have to battle. I don't want him to walk the dog, and I'm not saying that, you know, he is walking the dog, but right now he is a little bit step ahead of the guys for sure. So it will be interesting, but I think all eyes are going to be on the 450 class this weekend, Heavy D.
Yeah, the 450 class is going to be, just like you say, Jet and Hunter, they've did their thing in the 250 class, but 450 class is a different story, you know. Webb's right there. Sexton's still right there. I mean, Tomac and Webb, let me rephrase that. I'm sorry. Tomac and Webb. So, yes. Yeah, all eyes is on that because they put on a show.
No, they're going to for sure, and it is going to be awesome. And we get to see them race a lot, get to see them on the track a lot, so that will be good. And yeah, I can't wait. And man, if you're not a fan, you're really missing out. Like, all the guys at work, they do not care about the sport, and it's like unbelievable. We work a blue collar job, and you guys are not stoked on the gnarliest sport, and these guys being so close in the title fight. But hey, you know, whatever. You know, it's the greatest sport ever. It's the greatest sport on earth. It's the greatest sport on earth. Nobody can ever tell me any different. So, but man, what a phenomenal episode, number 21. Here on the Imperative MX podcast, we spoke with Kyle Bitterman about his AMA Arenacross Championship, second overall this year. Then we got into some real local with Jed Drye, the local legend segment brought to you by Dirt Industries Custom Graphics, talking about his local motocross racing, riding the banana this weekend, the Ridge MX, and a lot more from Jed and Kyle, the two call-ins on this episode. And then, of course, we wrapped it up with a little bit of Supercross talk coming up this weekend in Glendale, so don't miss out on that. And a big thanks again to the companies who make this all possible: West Virginia Motorsports, FXR, Dirt Industries Custom Graphics, Silver Valley MX Park, Hydropower, Mika Metals, and Total Control Racing Suspensions. Well, thank you guys so much for listening to this week's episode of the Imperative MX Podcast. Make sure to follow us on YouTube, Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, Facebook, Apple, Spotify, and check out imperativemx.com when you get the chance, and all of these social media platforms. From myself, Zach Newberry, and co-host
Heavy D,
we're out. See y'all next week.
Peace.